Hi everyone, welcome to the History Shelf, a weekly history podcast. My name is Sophie, and every week we will be taking a look at different events from world history. Today we will be talking about the Romanov dynasty, so let's start. What I find particularly interesting about the Romanov dynasty is that they managed to hold control of Russia for over 300 years, which is something that's not really common in European history. They reigned from 1613 until 1918, after the Tsar, his wife, and their five children were killed by Bolshevik troops following the orders of Vladimir Lenin after the Russian Revolution. And as I said, it's not very common for a same dynasty to hold power for 300 years, considering as well as we'll be seeing in just a moment that there were many moments, many instances when it wasn't really clear who was to be the heir. Many moments when several women inherited the throne, which in other contexts may have led to just simply another family taking over. But that wasn't the case. Okay, so as I said, they came, the Romanov family, they ascended the throne in 1613. Before that, they were already prominent members of the aristocracy, but in 1613, the Siemski Sobor, which was a sort of feudal Russian parliament, elected Mikhail Romanov as the new Tsar of Russia. And before he became Tsar, Russia had been suffering from a period of anarchy and famine, commonly known as the Time of Troubles. In contrast, Mikhail's reign was quite prosperous. He actually managed to settle peace with Sweden and Poland, which were much more powerful back then than they are now, or that they were later in European history. And then both countries had been occupying Russia up to that point. During Mikhail's reign as well, most of Siberia was conquered, and Russia saw the greatest territorial expansion of its time. The first Romanov Tsar, he fell ill in April 1645, and he died the following July. He was succeeded by his only son, Alexei. And from the start, Alexei was quite different from his father. Unlike him, he had actually been groomed for command, and he received a very thorough education through his tutor, Boris Morozov. And this man, Boris Morozov, he was very influential during the Tsar's early reign, to the point that he even chose Alexei's wife, who was the daughter of one of Morozov's own supporters. The Tsar was very popular with the common people, he was very loved, they saw him as a gentle and pious ruler. But his mentor was not as loved as him, as himself. They just saw him, the common people saw him as a typical greedy landowner. A new tax on salt at the beginning of Alexei's reign caused violent riots, which forced the Tsar to send Morozov into exile in order to appease the people. But he strictly returned to Russia 4 months later, but he had lost most of his powers. But by then, the Tsar could rule by himself. He went to war against Poland, Sweden, and Persia, and he made several military reforms in the process. By this time, Alexei had found a new advisor, Nikon the Metropolitan, which is a Eastern Orthodox name for bishop, of Novgorod. They had a great relationship at first, but it soured with time due to Nikon's involvement in political affairs. In 1653, the by then Patriarch Nikon, which is a sort of pope, not really, you have several patriarchs, but the Patriarch of Russia is one of the most important. There seems to be a firefighter. Sorry, I'm going on. I'm sorry. So the by then Patriarch Nikon issued a series of reforms on the practices of the Russian Orthodox Church. This eventually led to a lasting schism known as the Raskol. Several religious sects who denounced the new practices appeared, its followers calling themselves the Old Believers. The Tsar Alexei was married twice, fathering 13 children, with his first wife Maria, and three with his second wife, Natalia. In January 1676, his eldest surviving son, Fyodor, became the next Tsar. Fyodor Romanov was an intelligent man, but of very poor health. He was crippled from the day of his birth. His tutor, Simeon Polotsky, exposed Fyodor to Western European ideas and way of life. From the start, the new Tsar wanted to reform and modernize Russia, making changes to the military, reducing the influence of the Orthodox Church in state affairs, and centralizing the government. Sadly, he wasn't able to carry out his reforms to the fullest, since he died after a short reign of only 6 years. Fyodor had married twice, but had no surviving children. Moreover, he hadn't issued any order regarding who was to succeed him to the throne. After his death, his brother Ivan, who was 16 years old, and his half-brother Peter, of only 10, both claimed the throne. The throne should have gone to the older brother Ivan, but he was considered infirm of body and mind. He also had a very poor health. So the boyars, the rich landowners, chose Peter. But the Strelsi, the Russian guardsmen, demanded that Ivan be made Tsar. Finally, the Duma decided that the brothers would reign as co-rulers, and a special throne with two seats was made for the two identical crowns. Tsar Ivan died in 1696, leaving 24-year-old Peter as the sole ruler of Russia. And you might have heard of this new Tsar, Peter Alexeyevich Romanov, later known as Peter the Great, reigned from 1682 until his death in 1725. He was regarded as highly energetic and intelligent, who continued to study throughout his life, as well as for being one of his country's greatest statesmen and reformer. Until his rule, Russia was considered a backward state outside of Europe's political affairs. The economy was based on primitive agriculture, and the military organization was outdated. But Peter was determined to turn Russia into a European nation, not just militarily, but also culturally. He traveled to Northern Europe and visited shipyards, factories, and workshops, and brought to Russia foreign experts to teach their skills to the local people. He also reformed the armed forces and the bureaucracy, and imposed several new taxes that helped balance the state's finances. Peter also banned the use of beers, which may sound strange, but his idea was to make Russia as Western as possible, not just in the technological aspect, as well as these little things like the use of beers. He also promoted the usage of European clothing, for example, and art forms that have been banned by the Russian Orthodox Church, such as portraits, instrumental music, and dramatic productions, which were considered by the Russian Orthodox Church as being heretic. They entered the mainstream of the nation's cultural life. By the mid-18th century, Russians were producing ballets, operas, chamber music, Baroque architecture, and novels. But one of Peter the Great's largest legacy was the construction of St. Petersburg, built on merchant territory won to Sweden, which in 1712 was declared the new capital of Russia. Peter also led Russia to victory in the Great Northern War against Sweden and the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, which effectively established the newly founded Russian Empire as a new power in Europe. Peter died in 1725, leaving behind two contenders to the throne, his widow Catherine and his grandson, a child of the son Peter had with his first wife. After a short struggle for power, Catherine I was crowned as Empress of Russia at the age of 41, but she had little will of her own, trusting her advisors in everything. During her rule, the Supreme Private Council of Imperial Russia was founded in 1726, which had to approve all edicts issued by the Empress. Even though her reign was short, as she died about 2 years after being crowned, Catherine opened a legal path for future female rulers in Russia. The new emperor, Peter II, was only 11 years old. He was the son of Alexei Petrovich, the only son of Peter the Great to reach adulthood. From the start, it was obvious that the young emperor had no desire to rule. The first months of his reign were dominated by Alexander Menshikov, who had been a close advisor to Peter and Catherine. Menshikov arranged for his daughter and Peter to become betrothed before he fell in disgrace and was exiled to Siberia. The young Tsar then had a new favorite, Ivan Dolgorukov, who introduced him to the amusements of hunting. Young Peter soon forgot about state matters and moved the capital to Moscow, where he had been hunting, but he had better hunting grounds than in marshy St. Petersburg. In 1730, Emperor Peter fell ill with smallpox and died soon after. His death marked the end of the Romanov dynasty in the male line. There were now 5 candidates to the throne of Russia, all female. The 3 daughters of Ivan V, who had been Peter the Great's half-brother and co-ruler, Catherine, Anna, and Praskovia, and the 2 surviving daughters of Peter the Great himself, Anna and Elizabeth. Finally, the Russian Supreme Private Council, composed of the most powerful noblemen, selected Anna, the second daughter of Ivan V, to be the new Empress of Russia. She was chosen due to being a childless widow with no strong connections in Russia, which would make her easy to control. Before ascending the throne, the Supreme Private Council forced Anna to sign so-called conditions, limiting her power to the council's approval. But after arriving in Moscow, she realized what a strong position she was in and invalidated the conditions. But Anna had not received a proper education and soon lost interest in state matters, leaving the empire virtually in the hands of her favorite Ernst Johann von Biron. A year after coming to power, the Supreme Private Council was disintegrated and replaced with the Cabinet of Ministers. Anna and Biron had a strong preference for foreigners, moving them up the military and administrative ladder, which caused resentment among the Russian aristocracy. During her reign, Russia went to war against the Ottoman Sultanate and defeated the Crimean Khanate. Empress Anne died childless in 1740. Short before her death, Anna had appointed her grandnephew Ivan as her heir. The problem was that the new emperor Ivan VI was less than a year old when he was proclaimed emperor and his mother regent. You can guess what happened. His rule lasted only 13 months, after which he was deposed by Elizabeth, Peter the Great's daughter, who had the support of the Russian National Army and the French ambassador in Russia. The new Empress Elizabeth, who was 32 years old, reminded people of her father. She had a combination of Russian and Western ideas and a good diplomatic tact. Elizabeth led Russia during two of the most important European conflicts of the 18th century, the War of Austrian Succession and the Seven Years' War. She firmly adhered to a pro-Austrian and anti-Prussian foreign policy and improved relations with Great Britain. During Elizabeth's reign, the Winter Palace, Catherine Palace, and Peterhof were renovated and refurbished. Elizabeth's court was a very lavish and her reign is remembered as a period of luxury and excess. Unmarried and childless, the Empress appointed her nephew, son of her sister Anna, as heir. He had been born in German lands, as Carl Peter von Holstein-Gottorp, and had originally been named heir to the Swedish throne, but was brought to Russia at the age of 14 by orders of his aunt Elizabeth. He then converted to Eastern Orthodoxy, changing his name to Peter, and married his cousin, Princess Sophie of Anhalt-Zerbst, later baptized as Catherine. Once again, the new Tsar's rule was a short one. Peter III didn't like Russia or its people, and spent most of his time playing war games. His strong pro-Prussian policy made him withdraw his troops from the Seven Years' War and make peace with Prussia when victory was already secured. He was not loved by the court, and the Orthodox Church was resentful towards him for trying to implement Lutheran practices. But Peter also had a liberal nature, and during his six-month reign, he proclaimed religious freedom, fought government corruption, and banned the killing of serfs. Still, the masses' discontent grew stronger, and a conspiracy to overthrow him was planned. The leader of this conspiracy was none other than his wife Catherine. Peter later died under suspicious circumstances while being in prison. Even though the new Empress Catherine II was a foreigner, she was very loved by the Russian people. She learned to speak the language and convert to Orthodoxy, making an effort to seem worthy of ruling the land. Her main political goal was to strengthen the autocracy in Russia and decrease the power of the aristocracy. She also sought to expand Russia's borders and to continue the process of westernization begun by Peter the Great. Catherine also had a great interest in culture, the arts, and education, and she corresponded with figures of the Enlightenment such as Voltaire and Diderot. Her policy towards the serfs was not so liberal, which led to several rebellions, the most known one being Pugachev's rebellion during 1773 and 1775. During her marriage to Peter and after his suspicious death, Catherine took several lovers whom she promoted to high office. Catherine died on 1796 of a stroke and was succeeded by her son Paul, a nervous man who Catherine claimed had not been fathered by her husband Peter. Emperor Paul grew up neglected by his mother, who kept him away from government affairs and considered bypassing him in the succession in favor of Paul's son, Alexander. But after her death, Paul seized his chance and took the throne. The new emperor focused on imposing order and discipline in the country and the army, and going back in many of his mother's reforms. He persecuted the free thinkers and restricted many of the freedoms Catherine had granted to the nobility. Paul clearly did not want to share power with anyone. He also established the succession laws to the Russian throne as male primogeniture, stopping the tradition of the current ruler being able to choose his heir. In the international stage, Paul joined the Second Coalition against Napoleon's France in 1798. Paul's harsh military discipline and his clear preference for his Kachina Palace troops gained him the resentment of the army. Paul was murdered in 1801 as a result of a conspiracy organized by his own advisor and officers of the guard, who wanted to install Paul's son, Alexander, on the throne. Emperor Alexander I was brought up by his grandmother Catherine and received an excellent education. He was crowned at the age of 23 and was extremely popular from the beginning. His first liberal reforms were to the prohibition of corporal punishment and release all those who had been imprisoned by his father. In 1803, the emperor issued an edict that allowed landlords to free the serfs. This made him even more popular with the common people. But by far Alexander's greatest legacy is his involvement in the Napoleonic Wars. At the beginning of his reign, he re-established an alliance with England but maintained peaceful relations with France, hoping to moderate Napoleon's expansionism. But after Napoleon declared himself emperor in 1804, Russia and Austria declared war on France. They were defeated at the Battle of Austerlitz, after which Russia became an ally of Napoleon. Most of Russians found this alliance disgraceful, and the emperor's popularity dropped. By 1810, the Franco-Russian relation became increasingly worse, and Napoleon finally invaded Russia in 1812. The conflict that followed was called the Patriotic War by the Russians, where they showed outstanding resistance and endurance. Napoleon managed to reach Moscow itself, but the city was abandoned and had been set on fire by free Muscovites. The French retreated after that, and Alexander entered Paris triumphantly in March 1814. Emperor Alexander died 10 years later, a troubled man, crushed, in his own words, beneath the terrible burden of a crown. Even though Emperor Alexander had several illegitimate children, he had a bad relationship with his wife, and he only had two daughters who died in infancy. So the crown passed to his younger brother, after his older brother Constantine renounced his claim to the throne. So began the reign of Emperor Nicholas I. His coronation day was notoriously marked by an attempted coup d'etat that was later called the Decembrist Revolt, which greatly influenced the nature of his future reign. He is remembered by history as a classic autocrat, both in behavior and policy. His government exercised censorship and control over education, publishing, and many other aspects of public life. He put most of his trust in the military, appointing officers in key positions of the country. When it came to the matter of serfdom, Nicholas was personally against it and considered it evil, but he also thought that an immediate abolition of this institution would cause an economic and social catastrophe. Despite the rather harsh political regime, literature and art flourished, and the Industrial Revolution gradually reached Russia, with railways, highways, and telegraph lines being built. Nicholas I died in 1855 and was succeeded by his son Alexander. Unlike his father, Alexander II lacked interest in military matters. The beginning of his reign was marked by the Crimean War, after which he focused his attention on implementing a series of radical reforms in the military and administration, as well as attempting to improve communication in Russia and on developing its natural resources. Alexander had great interest in the wants and needs of the common people. In February 1861, the emperor abolished serfdom in Russia, liberating more than 22 million serfs. The act earned Alexander not only public love and respect, but also the affectionate name of the Great Liberator. On the 13th of March 1881, the emperor was mortally wounded by a terrorist bomb. This was not the first assassination attempt the emperor experienced. There were at least three more, but this one, unfortunately for the Tsar, was successful. After the death of the Liberator, his son Alexander III ascended the throne. He had been born as the second son and thus been brought up for a military career, but after his brother's death, he became the heir to the Russian crown. He was a very big and athletic built man, with a very conservative mindset. He was determined to strengthen autocracy in Russia. Despite his military upbringing, Alexander hated war and avoided it throughout his reign, resolving conflicts with Turkey and Afghanistan without resorting to arms. Alexander's political ideal was a nation containing only one nationality, one language, and one religion. He imposed the use of the Russian language and Russian schools on German, Polish, and Finnish subjects, and heavily persecuted Russia's Jewish population. The Tsar became ill with a kidney disease in 1894, dying the 1st of November of that year in the arms of his wife. When Nicholas I succeeded his father in 1894, he had very little experience of government. He was naturally timid and was heavily influenced by his wife throughout his reign. He encouraged Russia's expansion into Manchuria, which led to war with Japan in 1904. the resulting defeat, the first time a European power was defeated by a nation country, led to riots, strikes, and demands of radical reforms. Nicholas was then forced to establish a parliament known as Duma. Still, its power was limited and the Tsar shut it down on several occasions. He approved Russia's mobilization in August 1914, which led to this country's disastrous involvement into World War I. After some retreats and the loss of Poland, Nicholas assumed the role of commander-in-chief of the army. This proved to be a big mistake, not only because the Tsar had no military experience, but also because all losses were now personally associated with him. With Nicholas at the front, domestic issues and control of the capital were left to his wife Alexandra. However, Alexandra's relationship with Grigory Rasputin and her German background further discredited the dynasty's authority. By early 1917, Russia was on the verge of total collapse. The war had taken 15 million men from the farms and food prices had soared. In February, widespread demonstrations began in the capital, Petrograd. The Tsar had lost the support of the army and was thus forced to abdicate in favor of his brother Mikhail, who rejected the crown. A weak provisional government was then established. The Tsar and his family were held in various locations, eventually being imprisoned in Yekaterinburg in the Ural Mountains. In October 1917, the Bolsheviks, a Marxist faction, overthrew the provisional government, an attempt to seize power, which plunged Russia into civil war. As anti-Bolshevik troops approached Yekaterinburg, the decision to execute Nicholas and his family was taken. They were led to the basement on the excuse that the house was about to be bombarded. There, several soldiers were already waiting for them. Immediately after they occupied the chairs, the guardsmen read out the sentence and the whole family was gunned down. Thus came the end to the Romanov dynasty. Thank you so much for listening, everyone. This is my first podcast, so I hope I'll improve in the future. We also have an Instagram account. I'll leave the link to the website there, which I'm still working on. The Instagram page is The History Shelf. Just look it up, it should show up. Once again, thank you so much for listening and see you next week. Bye bye.